Thank you. Thank you, Diksha, for a fantastic introduction. And I'm very, very grateful for getting this opportunity from TEDx. And thanks to Meet to actually give me the opportunity. First of all, I want to say that's a very, very impressive story that I know Kapil just shared. I mean, I thought I was going to say something that started late, but he just beat me to it by saying something that is so phenomenal. I mean, more than the accomplishment, it's about how late it started and you know, where it ended. It's awesome. So I just want to make sure that people can see my screen. I'm projecting something. Yeah, perfect. So it's shown now. Yeah, so today's the topic that I'm going to have today is not about, while I traveled a lot, it's not about travel itself, especially given the current situation. I don't want to talk about travel because of the whole, you know, all of us being grounded. It's about the lessons that I've learned from my serial traveling, right? What all has you know, come into my life as a life lesson rather than just travel. So the agenda is very straightforward. I just want to talk about two topics. Like, why do I travel? I mean, I've been to so many countries, but despite you know, so much of traveling, what keeps me going? What fuels my travel, and why am I still so passionate about the next country or the city that I'm going to? Right, and more than that, what have I learned from these travels? Right, not just about travel itself. What have I taken back as lessons from travel that we can apply in daily life? And so that's what I want to share with you. And then I'm very happy to say that some of the points that Kapil just shared is very, very you know, resonating with what I'm going to be saying there too. Yeah, first of all, who am I? Like Diksha said, yeah, I grew up in South India. I started in Chennai, and I took a typical route of migrating to the US and settling down. But my life is anything but simple from there on. It's a very complicated. I'm not the usual go from India, go settle in a foreign place, and then come back to India, right? And some people are gone back again. Mine is not that straightforward, so I'm not going to go through each of these journeys, but having lived in six countries, and especially across 15 different cities, has given a very different perspective of how me and my wife, who's shared this journey with me throughout, how do we look at the world itself has changed over every one of these migrations, right? So people keep asking me, are you an Indian? Are you an American? So I don't know, my heart still feels Indian, my mind thinks like American, but overall there is this growing thing that's in the world, which is transnational, as people call themselves. I don't identify myself with any specific place where I lived. I mean, in every place I learned something, and I keep growing and evolving through those growths, right? But who am I really? Right? I mean, why am I a serial traveler? So while I have lived in different places, the travel is what has interested me. So I didn't put this slide just to make it sound like I've been to these places. It's not a milestone, but I just want to say that all these have, every one of these destinations, every one of these experiences have taught me something that I'm going to be sharing a little bit with, right? So how did it all start? I know Ankur here is my college mate. I don't know how many else knows about Pilani. I was not a classic BITS Pilani student. I mean, I didn't even have a passport until I was 25. Every one of my colleagues, the national path from Pilani was to app abroad and go to the States, right? That was it's like, you know, in India, if you grow up, you got to get married. If you get married, the next stage is you got to make kids. And if you make, that's a progression that happens. So typically for Pilani or any engineering folks, right, you have to write GRE, you have to go to US, and you have to settle down. I didn't do that. I was very much in my own bubble. But what happened was I met my wife, Pilani. She was my batchmate, and we've been with each other for more than 25 years now. So as a course of thing, as you all might know, you can't live your dream life, you know, playing the guitar and living your happy life, right? So somewhere down, I had to settle down. And the fact that I got to get a job and everything, so it was a natural course. And that point, for people who might not be familiar, there was this big thing called Y2K, the millennial bug, right? So there is a big migration of engineers that happened from here all the way to US. That's where it started. And going to America opened up a huge, for me, they call it the land of opportunities. For me, it was opportunity in the form of travel, right? Slowly started as domestic travel, then it kept going in. So that's where it started. It was not I wanted to travel. So why do I travel? I mean, because it's there is different people have different reasons. I know some people who chase milestones. I know some people who chase you know, certain things to you know, click pictures and kind of a social validation. For me, the very simple reasons why I love traveling. The first one is the seductions of a foreign land. Right? What do you mean by seductions? It's anything exotic excites me. Like it could be the language, it could be the script, it could be it, and it doesn't have to be international. Even when I land into Odisha, right, I mean, the fact that the entire language and script and the food and everything is different excites me. So I keep going in search of that. Like if you look at the picture of Tajikistan, Shadia, I've seen enough volcanic lakes, but that particular volcanic lake which was there and that moment and that scenery just it rekindles my travel to keep doing it again and again, right? And have had enough of food in Africa, but when I landed in Cameroon, the food, specifically Shadia, I ate like I'd never seen food before, right? So this keeps fueling more and more to see, okay, what else is there out in the world, right? So that exotic thing is what keeps going, and it's not just international. I want to be very clear. So and the next destination in my itinerary is Bihar. So I'm going to learn so much about Bihar cuisine, which is not even known outside probably Bihar, right? And something like a Nalanda ruins is as cool as any Roman ruins that is outside India, right? So things like that is something that keeps exciting me. And the next thing is people say a lot about, hey, I'm not about materialistic things. It's more about memories, right? It's a millennial thing and post-millennial thing. And this has really played out in my life. My wife and I were very well settled, like the typical Indian immigrants to America, buy your car, you know, buy your home, collect as many mortgages as possible, you know, be in debt. I mean, I was the classic example of all those, right? I love my car, I love the homes. And those boxes are actually from one of the relocations that I showed you. We had so many things, but right now we live out of two suitcases. So what transformed, right? So any day, I mean, if you ask me, how was your experience driving a car or living at that home in Seattle? I mean, any day I'll take what's on the right. And I these memories, like what I did in all these places, stand out. Even today, I don't even know now which side of the car I was sitting in because we now owned a car for the last 12 years or so. So, but I know that very moment standing on top of that summit there in the mountain, holding on to my Heineken beer, which I remember that moment very well because it was something that is unforgettable. It is something that I remember probably for the next 50 years. So somewhere down the line, as a family, we started realizing these memories are long lasting rather than a materialistic thing like buying a car or a home or even a device for that matter. And the third most important thing is I hope everybody here kind of grasps what I'm going to say here, because the first international trip we did was from Seattle to the Caribbean island of Jamaica because we wanted to go and see a cricket match. Until then, I didn't even realize. This sweet waiter asked us, hey, this is the Jamaican food, this is our national food. Then he turned to us and asked, what is Indian food? Like, what's your national food? Right at the very moment, I didn't know where to start. Right? I mean, I grew up in Chennai. I have origins in Andhra, and my wife is from Karnataka, and I studied in Rajasthan, and I've been through most of India, so I didn't even know what is Indian food. So that's just like a one representation of how big the cuisine is, right? We have like, you know, hundreds of sweets alone can be, you know, running in hundreds, right? It's not just a dish. So that's when I realized, wow, like the treasures we have in India, I still am discovering India every day. Every time I go to a new place, I see like, wow, like India has so much more to offer than an entire continent put together, right? So that feeling, I didn't know when I was at home. I didn't know when I was studying in Rajasthan. Only when we start going out and we see what home has to offer, right? And this is not just for people from India. It's from people from US. When they go over this work, then they realize how comfortable their lives are. Right? So that's very, very important. Only when you go out, you see and appreciate what you have. And the next thing is don't take for granted. I mean, we are complaining about traffic and complaining about, you know, it takes 30 minutes to go from point A to point B. My puri is not hot enough as I thought. And we've been to places where people are living within the walls, right? The stories we heard from, these are real pictures from my travels. I mean, the pictures tell the story. The people in Palestine, or people in Bosnia, people in Lebanon, we met people who lived through war all their life. I met people who have met each other, married, brought up a kid, educated the kid, all while living in a refugee camp. Right? These are very, very hard situations out there. So when I come back, I'm very happy. I don't mind sitting in the 40 minute of traffic. I'm not going to complain because what we have, we are blessed, right? So travel does teach you to open up and understand and appreciate what you have. You should be blessed about, right? That's very, very important. And reinventing myself, right? every phase of our travels has taught something as a family to both me and my wife. So I just have to call out, though the articles and everything have called out that I've traveled and everything, it's every one of those countries pretty much. My wife has been with me through the journey. So we learn all these lessons together. So one of the things is, yeah, I was a stereotypical work in Microsoft. Yeah, climb the corporate ladder. And what do you do? Next goal was very similar to any other Indian tech person, right? But somewhere down the line, it changed. I think only when you go out, you start reflecting. You don't see things when you are at your home. I mean, that's why all these business retreats and everybody go outside somewhere to start about, plan about strategy and things like that. So for us, personal planning happened when we were outside. Like this classic example is a picture on the right? When we are sitting there in Ivory Coast on the beach, we were just having coffee and looking at all those kids playing ball. I mean, they didn't care about whether they had a Samsung or an iPhone. They didn't care where they're going to app. They didn't care whether they're going to, you know, top the SAT score or GRE, right? For them, it was just a football game and they were just enjoying the beach. Same happened in Kiribati. If you look at those two kids on the left, they didn't care about what kind of restaurant they were dining in. It's a simplistic pleasure. This is the India we grew up in. So we started appreciating and slowly abandoning our chase towards going back and saying, when you're 70 or 80, I'm not going to be craving for, oh, I didn't get one more promotion, but I would rather live a life that I woke up to something that I'm passionate about. So these kind of reinvention didn't happen when we are in Seattle. It happened when we are on an island like Sabah, on the island like Sumba, looking at the island lifestyle, thinking about why can't we simplify our life, right? And this probably you guys have heard about it. It's a very quote which a lot of people get attributed to, but one of my favorite quotes is, if you know, traveling is, the world is like a book. And if you never travel, you just read one page, right? And for us, most of the real educations have happened in travel. I mean, I've been to Afghanistan, where talking to the locals and understanding the geopolitical situation, which never has happened from all the news channels I see or all the books I read. The stories we heard in Sudan and South Sudan, these are not stories, even if you follow the popular celebrities fighting for, you know, Darfur and things like that, the stories on the ground are very different. Similar in East Timor, similar in Kiribati. I can keep talking about so many of these things. The real lessons actually happened when we are on the ground. I mean, we didn't even know the kind of games that were played in a poor island like East Timor, right? That could have been the next Bali, but what all happened there, it's horrifying stories, which never get published anywhere, right? Like they say, history is written by the winners, right? Not the losers. So most of the education about the places or the people or the culture has happened on the ground by talking to people. And so that's what keeps fueling us more and more. And the last part is breaking prejudices, right? Prejudices are very important. I think the stereotyping. Right? I remember going, when I first migrated to the US, everybody thought all Indians can do yoga, all Indians can dance, of course, Bollywood, right? And so there are certain things which people were stereotyping. And that's when you start going on the ground and you talk to people, you realize, like Eritrea, it's always, all these countries are featured in most of the top 10 dangerous countries you should not go to. Right? What we learned in Eritrea, which is an Islamic country, was stunning. Like every bar, every restaurant was actually managed by a female staff, right? which doesn't even happen in India. That's not something you would expect, right? So the live and let live culture that was going on in Eritrea was very, very phenomenal. Same in Iraq. I mean, people asked, I like posting pictures with my beer scape, as I call it. People said, what is that? Is it lemonade or something like that? It's actually beer. We had some of the best night outs in Baghdad, which you would never ever read about if you follow the American channels, right? And similarly, Pakistan example is a classic. This is the Wagah border, but I'm not sitting on the Indian side. We are sitting on the other side in Pakistan. We drove from Lahore. And there are so many such things. Being on the ground in Pakistan, the Pakistan we see was very different than what people have seen through the Bollywood movies or what you're reading in the news. So I highly recommend people to travel mainly for this particular thing alone, right? Go and see for yourself, what does it mean to be a German? What does it mean to be a Serbian? Yeah, don't form judgments by just reading news channels. So now that's all about why I keep traveling. The next part is, what are the lessons that you learn from travel, right? There are four important lessons, which I will go into each of these. But I just want to talk about at a high level, right? So which is overcome inertia is what Kapil already touched on, which is very happy to hear that. Because these are the four key things that keep repeating in my travel. And I keep applying that to my life also as my life goals, right? So what are these? I'll go into each one of those. Yeah, like I told you, what surprises most people when I talk about my travel is until 25, I didn't even have a passport. I mean, I did travel to all these countries within a span of 15 years, but I didn't even have a passport. So until I got married, that's when I got the a US job, and then I first applied for my passport. I'm pretty sure most of my Pilani mates, each of them have their passport or probably even traveled outside India at some time, right? So I lived in my own bubble. It's not as phenomenal as Kapil's story where he started running into the treadmill at 33, but still, till 25, somebody's not had a passport. It is very a scary profile, right? And then it started somewhere. Like the first step you got to take, I don't know how many people have read Good to Great by Jim Collins. It's a very interesting concept called the flywheel concept. You start spinning the first few cycles, and that is a break point. It hits, and after that, it starts spinning. I mean, you don't have to keep doing it after that. So what started as a let's travel once in a while, then we started doing it every long weekend, then it almost became every weekend, right? So it kept going on and on. It's like I call it Crossing the Chasm by Geoffrey Moore book. I don't know if you read it. I apply that to my personal thing too. Don't wait for it. I mean, I know so many people who say, I'm going to start quitting smoking from tomorrow. I'm going to start hitting the gym from tomorrow. There is a huge inertia, but the minute you start somewhere, just do it, like they call it cold turkey. That's it. I mean, you're going to discover a very different world. I've applied that to my personal life too. I used to be a heavy smoker, and one fine day I said, I don't want to smoke. That same, quitting sugar was not easy. I'm a sweet tooth person. One fine day, my wife challenged me to say, can you drink this coffee without sugar? I tried it and I didn't mind. And then I quit sugar completely. So similar to, I'm writing my book and I was just pushing it all these months. And suddenly, thanks to the pandemic, we are grounded. And one fine day I started and I can't just stop writing more and more into the book every day, right? So overcoming the inertia is a very important thing. Like Kapil said, if you jump into the treadmill the first time, if you do your first trip, somewhere, then you don't have to worry about chasing your goal. And the next thing is building into your lifestyle. I never treat a travel as a special exercise. It's not like, let me wait for my holiday. Let me go when there is some special deal coming in. It might start like that, but somewhere down the line, only when you make it habitual. It's like travel for us is like going and eating out. Travel for us is going and socializing and or having a night out in town. So we don't treat it special. So we don't have a bucket list that we are chasing. So it's like a second skin, and that's what has kept us going all these years, and that's worked very well in my personal life too. People ask, how do I lose weight and everything? Fitness is not like a course that you take. It should be a mindset, right? Same like dieting. Once you become a healthy eater, nobody has to teach you what